Welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast, brought to you by TournamentPokerEdge.com, the only podcast dedicated exclusively to tournament poker strategy. And now, here are your hosts, Ron Fez Buddy and Killing Bird.
Welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. This is Killing Bird, here with my co-host, as always, Diego, Ron Fez Buddy. What's up, man?
I'm good, buddy. How you doing?
I am surviving.
You are a survivor?
You're
going to work harder?
I'm a survivor, yes.
You're going to work stronger?
I think I need to.
Can't wait to see you do the dance moves.
Oh, man. I'm saving that for a special video someday.
You're surviving. That's good. Yeah, I'm surviving, too. I'm on a downswing.
Yeah, same here. Yeah. Not the huge downswing, but just...
Yeah, well, your bankroll is...
Doing a lot of floating around.
Yeah, same here. You know, my bankroll is not big on merge, so any downswing is, like, you know, pretty much magnified. So I drop down, and I'm making it there, but I'm not final tabling, so it happens.
Right.
It's basically what we talked about last podcast. Not much.
Yeah. Yeah, we did this one so quick.
Yeah.
To the last one.
Yeah.
Not a lot has happened since then, but you know, I'm keeping busy with TPE stuff and whatnot. So
yeah, I've been watching a lot of poker lately. I DVR'd Sunday night. They ESPN2 had the whole WSOP Europe.
Right.
And I watched all 6 or 7 hours of that. And it was great because it was, you know, first of all, it was a lot of coverage. 7 hours is pretty cool. The WSOP Europe main event is, you know, just at least from 16 players on when they picked up is a lot of good players. I mean, you know, it's a, whatever, 10 euro buy-in, 10K euro buy-in, and there's 593 people playing it. It's not like the main event here in the States. So it's, you know, mostly a lot of good players, at least that made it deep. I don't know about the rest of the field when it started out. I know Mike Leah made a cashed and, you know, got not super far, but made a little bit of a run. So we can ask him about it. But the final two tables were really strong. I mean, it was Mormon. It was Antonius. Elio Fox, who, you know, casual players may not know, but Smoke Rock Flock on 2+2, a lot of live success this year, and he ended up winning it. He was great. Brian Roberts from 2 months, 2 million fame. A couple of good Euro pros. Moritz Kranich, I think his last name was.
I think that's how it's pronounced.
I'm getting to Jake Cody, you know, like the seventh person I mentioned. Like, you know, because he went out early
right.
The final table. And there were—I mean, I don't even remember who else. I'm sure there were other good players. So it was fun to watch these really good players play. And Antonius took a god awful beat. Did you see it?
No, I have it all DVR'd, but I have not watched.
I won't share that with you. But it was a god awful beat to Mormon. But it was really fun. It was a really aggressive table. It was you know, high level thinking. You could see a lot of high level thinking. Fox played fantastic. I've always really like when I see him post on 2+2. I read his threads because I know it's going to be some really, you know, advanced thinking.
Right.
And he did some awesome 3-bets and 4-bets that he got people to fold. And Mormon didn't – it was him and Mormon heads up. I'm not spoiling anything because I think everyone knows that Fox won.
Yeah, I knew that.
Mormon and Fox, you know, got heads up. And Fox ran over Mormon. Mormon didn't have great cards, but Fox just like ran over him with his, you know, every time he opened, he would just jam on him. He just kind of, he played the situation perfectly. And I don't think there's much Mormon could have done because he didn't get cards, but Fox, like, it's one of those situations where, you know, Mormon didn't really do anything wrong. He was opening, he was trying to take control, but Fox was just, you know, aware of that and playing
right
well and even better, you know, in many cases. So, both, it was just fun to watch those guys play heads up, really good stuff. So,
yeah, looking forward to watching it, especially because there's not a lot of poker on TV anymore.
You know, I've been also watching the big game on PokerStars.tv.
Oh, that's right. I forgot they still play that on there.
Yeah, they had they did 6 weeks before they canceled it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm on the middle of week 3 of the second season. And it's fun. It's fun. This is the one with Jared Huggins from 2+2, the guy who was homeless and playing for charity, and you know, he's playing really tight. I'm halfway through the week. I'm not sure how it ends up for him. But the play is great. You got Locke. I'm not sure if this week is Bryn Kenny. You know, Bryn Kenny Brinkenny was last week, and Nanonoko was there last week. They got a lot of good, you know, just good, aggressive, even internet players on this year, so it's pretty fun to watch.
Yeah,
that's what I'm.
Yeah, I have to go back and watch that because I forgot that was available to watch on the internet, so I have to go back and check that out.
Yep, and for all you know, TP members and the people around the world, the PokerStars announced the Turbo Coupe, which is pretty cool. I think. That should be fun to watch. I'm definitely gonna sweat some of those. A lot of our pros are going to play that in, and I think we're actually going to try to get a Turbo Series from Danny in before, or actually a Turbo Series from that from Danny. I think we talked about that with him last week.
Yeah.
From Danny N13 when he plays that. So a lot of stuff going on. Even though we're not playing as much, still the poker world is moving on, and that Sunday million, 10 million guarantee, they crushed it, huh?
Yeah. Sounds like it. Jeez.
Yeah. It's amazing. It's the poker world is moving on. It's still expanding. It's still growing. We're going to, you know, I'm confident we're going to get it here, and we're just going to pick up and keep going. I think it's going to be.
Yeah. Just a matter of time.
Just a matter of time.
Just only hard part is being patient.
Yeah. But man, I'm learning. I'm studying like crazy. I'm just watching the videos. I'm, you know, playing less, like we talked about this, playing less tables. You know, I'm taking advantage of this time where I think I probably played too much when we were able to play, and now I'm making sure that I'm learning the game and keeping up with the trend. So looking forward to it.
Cool. And and we mentioned that Mike will be coming on. Mike Leah will be coming on the podcast today, but we'll also have Shaun Hendrickson on, as we mentioned in the last episode, to talk about his WPT run down in Tampa, Florida.
Yep, final table. Pretty cool.
Yeah, so looking forward to hearing some hands from his experience down there. And of course, Mike's a great player and has a ton of live experience, so it'll be really good to hear his feedback on some of those hands as well. And then we'll catch up with him on what else he has going on. So
cool.
Should be a good episode.
Let's bring him in.
Cool. So we'll take a quick break, and then we'll come back with Mike and Shaun on the Tournament Poker Edge podcast.
Hey, MTTers. This is Casey Big Dog Pocket Fives Jarzebeck from TournamentPokerEdge.com. If you've been looking for a trading site dedicated exclusively to tournament poker, then look no further. Tournament Poker Edge is only $23.95 per month, with no initial sign-up fee, and we post a new training video every weekday. You'll also find poker-related articles, blogs, and very active strategy forums. We even offer you the ability to upload your own video for others to discuss. So head on over to TournamentPokerEdge.com and find out why it's quickly becoming the destination for tournament poker players looking to take their game to the next level. TournamentPokerEdge.com.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. Time now to bring in our pros, Shaun Hendrickson and Mike Leah. How's it going, gentlemen?
Great. Hello.
Yo.
Hi.
Why do you talk like that?
It's early for these guys, I think.
We haven't got any of Derek's new sound effects yet. I figured he'd throw one in already.
Oh, it's just a matter of time.
I can't wait.
So I guess, you know, as we mentioned in the intro to the podcast, we're going to talk quite a bit about Shaun's WPT final table run. But before we do that, Mike, it's been a little bit of time since we've had you on the podcast, so we should probably catch up with what you've been up to and what you got going on in the poker world. So I know you just got back – well, not just got back, but recently returned from Europe, playing some events over there. How'd that go?
It was good. It was a good trip. It's kind of last minute after WCoop, but I went over for the World Series of Poker, played a few prelims in the main events. Went kind of deep in the main event, made the money, but it's kind of similar to my WCoop main event where I was nursing a short stack for way too long and couldn't quite make it far enough in this one.
Yeah.
And
Did you feel like any extra confidence playing? I mean, I know you probably have confidence to begin with your game, but just coming off of the big win, how'd you feel playing?
Yeah, like, well, it kind of was rushed, and I I flew like overnight to Europe and tried to play the next day, and so that never goes too well for me. I usually, you know, end up punting a little bit more than usual.
Right.
But I don't know. But by the time the main event got around, I was playing much more deep stack and had way more time. And when I kind of got into that same scenario, being short stack deep, it was easy to think back about how it worked out for me in WCOOP. So I think when you have a successful run. As a short stack, it definitely gives you more confidence the next time.
Did you did you play with anyone who made the final table? Because I don't know if you saw it, but I just watched basically like 6 or 7 hours of the coverage on ESPN2 the other night.
I played with day three. Yeah, we made the money on day three. So Patrick Antonius was on my starting table and on my direct left going into the bubble and after the bubble and until I busted. When we were going through the bubble, he had our entire table covered.
Oh, jeez.
One seat to my left, so that was a pretty interesting dynamic.
He ended up
bubbling final table with a couple bad beats.
How did you think
the yields were over there?
Overall, fairly soft. There's a ton of great players, but there was a lot of local French players. So it was very, I guess it's similar to the World Series in Vegas, where it's very table dependent. You could have some amazing tables. You could have some tough tables. Then I went over to EPT San Remo, which was fun. I get pretty close to the money in the main event, but then final tabled a couple of the post-lims. And it's my first time in Italy, and I loved it over there. So that was a good trip.
Nice. So, do you think you'll do more international traveling now to play poker after that experience?
Yeah, I think I'm going to try and find some cool places to go. A little bit more flexible in my schedule now, so I'm going to try and pick some cool destinations. I can't see myself ever missing World Series Europe again, just for the the prize pools and the prestige and everything else, and trying to get that first bracelet.
Yep.
But took a good downtime after that trip, after WCOOP and that. So I've just been kind of taking it easy for the couple months, just sort of getting ready for the new year where I plan to start going hard again. And I just launched my own website, so took some time getting that ready, and so that's been pretty cool getting that up and running.
Nice. So what's the address?
MikeLeah.com. And going to use it basically to do a lot of coaching and promote my private coaching that I do, and looking forward to doing some fun fantasy sports things. And my Twitter and my blog and Facebook and stuff are all connected to that, so that's all there.
Very nice.
Very cool. Nice.
Yeah. So all our listeners, make sure and go check out MikeLeah.com for all the good stuff going on over there.
Yeah, there's a little coaching forum, so if you have a hand question or anything, feel free to ask it on there, and I'll try and answer a few every few days or so you can get some free hand advice on there too.
Awesome. Cool. Good luck with that.
Thanks, guys.
Yep.
And then we were actually just as we were getting ready to start recording, we were talking a little bit about the T-Coop coming up on Stars.
Yeah.
I assume you'll be playing most, if not all, of those events?
I'll be playing all 50 events, and I will be, I'm sure, trying to start some side action on 2+2 and Pocket Fives. So try and get some leaderboard contests going. I'm very excited about T-Coop. I was planning on playing all the Borgata events, but when Stars announced his schedule, I'm most likely going to come back home from PCA not most likely, I am going to be playing all of these events now. I've been waiting and begging for Turbo Coupe events for years, so they've finally given it to us, so it should be a lot of fun.
Nice.
You might have some trouble getting a leaderboard competition going after the last one you
had. There's always degenerates out there.
It's what you can count on is degenerates.
Yeah. So I don't like the buy-ins in T-Coop. There's some decent sized buy-ins, but for the most part, they're trying to appeal to everyone. So there's a lot of mid-stake buy-ins and stuff. So
the fields are going to be massive.
Extra action.
Yeah.
So the field just be ginormous. So.
Well, we'll be watching from the sidelines over here.
Stars, I miss you.
Yeah.
I read in the Merge thread on 2+2 that Merge is going to be doing a spring series, which is pretty cool. It's not going to be obviously the scoop, but it'd be nice to have a series to play on. So we'll be
Yeah, that would be great. I'm surprised it's taken them this long to do something.
Well, I mean, I don't think they
needed the the player base.
They need the player base. And remember, they weren't growing. You know, they weren't prepared for Black Friday, so I think the rush of customers, you know, came out of nowhere for them. So I don't know if administratively they were prepared for what happened. So it takes a little time, I guess, for them to catch up and, you know, start taking advantage of their position in the marketplace.
Tournament series are always fun. Like even, yeah. You know, UBOCs were pretty small comparative to the Full Tilt and Stars, but they were, you know, still great and a lot of fun and good competition, and so should be something hopefully for them to build from.
Cool. So talking about the series, Sean, congratulations.
Hi.
Congratulations. So basically, for those who don't know, we teased it earlier. Sean, final table, the WPT main event in, what was it, Orlando or Tampa?
Tampa, the Hard Rock.
There it is.
he final tabled it. Congratulations, but he finished fifth.
There's the boo.
Yeah, where's the boos? Very nice. Derek just realized that you could play sounds on your computer, so he's having fun.
Taking full advantage.
So congratulations on your fifth place. And so we thought we'd like to take some time today and go through some hands that you thought were interesting, talks from a strategic perspective. But just give us an overview. How what was the tournament like? How'd it go? What did it feel like to make the final table of such a
Well, I played – how many tournaments did I play over there? Four total. I played – and I have four hands. One's from the satellite that I won my seat into the main event. One from a $200 re-entry, and then I have two hands from the main event that I thought were good.
Nice.
But I went over there. The only reason I went over there was they were giving away seats in their cash games to these three satellites they were running. So you have all these cash game players, and I don't know if anybody's played poker in Florida, but they're not the greatest players in the world.
Yeah, they have such a reputation. Why is that?
Because it used to be in Florida, the rule was you could only play 2-2 limit for years.
Okay.
That was the biggest they had, and I think a year and a half ago they upped the stakes.
Right.
So you can play any games. So that's why all these tournament series are coming to Florida. Everybody, don't come here, though, because the players are really, really tough. But, on average, your players here are quite a bit worse than basically any other place I've played in the U.S.
It's new there, right?
It's new. Like, I mean, it's been a year and a half, and live poker in a year and a half. I mean, it's not like playing online. You still don't get that many hands in playing live, so the learning curve really hasn't caught up.
Wow.
For instance, the 2K main event here I thought was five times softer than a $300 tournament I played in November or October at MGM in Vegas.
Wow.
Yeah. I'm not even kidding. You do have some young online guys that do travel around Florida, and they actually gave me shit about not doing it. They're like, why don't you travel to everything in Florida?
Yeah, seriously.
And I said, I don't know. That's a good question. So I'm traveling around Florida more. I don't really see any need for me to leave Florida. It was a 2K main event. The levels are only 40 minutes. So for a 2K, you'd expect the levels to be a little longer, but it was kind of their first time running a big series there. So they'll learn and they'll adjust. But so it played a little bit shallower as you got later in the tournament but at the same time, people really didn't adjust. I mean, you'd see things like a guy raised under the gun for 3X. The guy on his left shoved for like six big blinds, folds to me on the button I fold, and the guy in the small blind who only has 11 big blinds shows me ace-king and folds.
Stop!
Hey.
I want to go. I know it's Christmas and I have a family, but I'm ready to go play.
What do you expect him to do? He didn't even have a pair.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
it's a drawing hand. So
it was unbelievable. Some of the things you'd see, like your mind is blown, and you kind of do have to adjust because they play so differently. You can't really. I mean, you have to really know the player you're playing against, if that makes sense. Because it's not like you can't even give them credit for being competent at all.
Absolutely. You know, I run into that a lot. I go to Vegas for conferences for my day job a lot. And, you know, when the day's done, I'll go play a tournament at, you know, Caesars or the Venetian at night for, you know, like a $120 tournament. And you see the same exact thing. I mean, most of the players are bad, but they're doing things like that. Or, you know, and or they call you
like unexpectedly when you think you have fold equity, or they fold when you think you have no fold equity. So it's very confusing. It takes some time to start to understand who's doing what, but you eventually get it, and then edge comes in. And
yeah, I mean, you start with 30K in chips, and my buddy was at one of the other tables, and I think like at the fifth level or sixth level, I think the blinds were only 200, 400, and one guy was already up to 300,000. he was just bombing. Just bomb play. He would 3-bet, like somebody would make it 1,200 and he'd 3-bet to 14,000. Okay. Just wait and pick up a hand, but he was just getting there. And, like, for instance, there was one hand late on day two where a guy made it 12,000 at 2,000, 4,000, and then the kid on my right 3-bet him to 112,000. And I look down at queens, and I'm just never folding queens to this guy.
No.
So I shove. And
he's
then
got
he
jacks, right?
No, he had eights.
Okay, yeah.
But he did call, so wow. I have to give him some credit. He realized he priced himself in.
Right.
So just things like that. And then he's like, oh, I guess I shouldn't have three bet so much. I'm like, oh, yeah, that probably would have been the first blow. So,
yeah.
Anyways. All right, you guys want me to go over some hands and yeah. then – Mike, you can tell me how bad I am.
At the end of this, we'll be like, how did you make the final table?
Exactly.
All right.
So the first one was from, I played the $275 satellite to the main event. One out of every 10 people got seats. Started with 7K in chips. The blinds started at 2550. Mind you, like I said, a lot of these people were the cash game players that had won
right.
seats in their hand giveaways. So I get dealt ace-king off. I think under the gun plus one. I raised to a 125. I got flatted three ways. The flop was king of diamonds, eight of diamonds, three of hearts. I was first stack, so I bet 275. The first flatter, who is this Asian younger gentleman who looked like he had to take off work from his lunch break to come play because he was dressed in a shirt and tie. All right. he makes it 775. So I have ace-king, no diamond. The board's king of diamonds, eight of diamonds, three of hearts. The other two fold. What do you think there?
How's an interesting spot.
Yeah, how deep are you guys again?
We're only 7K. Everybody was 7K to start. This might have been like the fifth hand or something. So we were both 7K deep.
Oh, you were that early. Okay.
Yeah, it was, like the fifth hand.
Like, basically, you have kind of, I guess, well, you have a few options, but really only two that I would consider. One is just folding, being that it's a satellite, and just
yeah.
you know, figuring that you're going to find better spots and you don't have to win the tournament. Or, of course, just call and kind of turn your hand into a bluff catcher. Or who knows, maybe
yeah.
even has a worse king that he's going to keep bombing. Or obviously a flush draw or complete air. But it's interesting in level one in the satellite.
Yeah,
because
it's a satellite. It's so different.
Like going into that hand, I'm probably going to play that hand very cautiously because, you don't have to really – chip up a ton in satellites. You want to protect your tournament life, but I sometimes may check the flop, but with three opponents in a satellite with a bunch of bad players, I'm probably going to try to get max value from that right from the start.
Especially with the flush draw out there, I figured I needed to bet.
Right. Yeah. No, I like the bet with three opponents.
But even in a satellite, is a guy with a flush draw doing this in a satellite like right away? First hand, or are they just going to play, three hands in, play a flush draw more cautiously?
Like I said, my question from before is he may have just figured, let's gamble it up so I can go back to work or I can get chips and have a chance to win.
Right.
I don't know. You really don't know what his, you know what I mean, his reasoning is at that point. So I honestly wanted to just fold in the flop, but I'm not that good.
Do you think he's doing this with worst kings ever? I mean, is this, or is worst kings just calling?
No, I think sometimes it's hard to tell when you know nothing about the opponent.
Right.
Yeah.
I think for the most part, like in a satellite, you can just assume everyone's going to kind of give you proper information.
Right.
So a lot of people will probably just call with flush draws and maybe just call with pairs and they're raising because they have a set.
Yeah, that's the first thing that I thought.
if I have no information at all, I'm usually just going to default to kind of just believing what they're telling me, unless they reason otherwise too. But so it's a pretty awkward spot. It, again, it, some of it might even just kind of sort of just depend on my mood and what I have planned for the rest of the day, whether I decide to maybe stack off here or just be a complete, just not a nip, but just make a really tight fold just because you don't really need the high variance play
yeah,
in a cheap satellite.
So I call, even though I did want to fold, but I did call. I mean, I completely understand your reasoning.
Yeah, I think the call is great. Like, I definitely don't like a repop. Unless,
oh, yeah, there's no point in raising there, I don't think. So the turn's the ace of hearts. So the board's king of diamonds, eight of diamonds, three of hearts, ace of hearts. Okay. Great turn for me.
Yeah.
I check. There's 2,050 in the pot. I check, and he automatically bets 2,000.
Okay.
Wow. Yeah,
so he probably has about, 40...
Yeah, like we had like 45,000
4,000 behind or something. Yeah, a little bit over 4,000.
I mean, like the card really shouldn't change so much unless he had like ace eight or something.
Right.
Or ace of diamonds, ace queen of diamonds, or ace jack of diamonds, ace ten of diamonds, I guess.
Right. At this point in this hand now, I probably, there's enough in there where I'd probably just go ahead and shove and put them all in, make him pay fully for his flush draw if he does have, two pair or some kind of combo draw. Obviously, you can maybe get him to call with, just ace high diamonds or something.
Yeah, definitely possible.
Right.
So I take the worst option and I just call. And then the river's a four diamonds. So the board's king of diamonds, eight of diamonds, three of hearts, ace of hearts, four diamonds. There's 6,000 in the pot. We each had like 4,400 behind. I checked, and he instantly checked back, and he had a set of threes.
Wow.
See, and then, well, that's one time where, it was good that you didn't set him in on the turn, because you got the scare card on the river that enabled you to save the bet. But.
Yeah, one of the reasons I didn't was it being a satellite, and I figured if he does have me crushed here...
Maybe he won't shove.
Yeah, and I still have 4,400, which ended up running up and winning a seat, so it worked out.
Right.
It was going to be tough for me to fold on a lot of rivers, though, if he shoved.
Right.
But I was trying to give him to hang.
Sometimes they don't shove. He might only bet another 2,000 for value, and then you save 2,400 by just calling. So
yeah, and you have a chance.
That's good. Yeah.
So I don't know. I just thought it was kind of a funky hand from 2,550 level in a satellite because the dynamics are so different.
Yeah, I mean, it just seems like you're going to be out of position, so the rest of the hand, right? Because he had position on you that whole hand?
Yeah, he had position.
And so, he might just keep bombing and you're going to have to keep putting money in with top pair.
Exactly.
It's just which is why, given the strength of his raise on the flop, my initial instinct is I just feel like in a satellite early – those guys are just going to call with their flush draws, with their weak pairs. So it's, either he's really kind of just really bluffing it up, that's part of it, or he's got the set. And, I guess in a satellite that early, I'm just going to play conservatively and just.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think I should have just folded on the flop. But just at the time, I'm like, am I really going to fold top top here on this guy?
I know.
Well, right. I don't even know if he might only have an hour for lunch, and he might have to get back to work. I really didn't know. I mean, he was all dressed up, and let's be honest, Asians like to gamble.
This hand's a good example of kind of having a plan for a hand, and then being able to change, and adjust midstream. Like my plan preflop when I get ace king at 2,550 with 7,000 chips is basically just to play it for value and trying to get value out of worse aces and kings. So, I want to keep the raise small and get people in. And then I'm probably going to pot control post flop, for the most part, but when I get three opponents and a bunch of weak players, I kind of say, okay, well, I'm going to try and get some good value. Hopefully someone has king queen and then you get raised and then you kind of have to sort of readjust again. And like, all right, maybe I'll just get out of the way. I would definitely, if he was just calling, I probably would have just bet that bet trying to get, max value. But
oh, absolutely. I think I definitely would have bet all three streets. If he
absolutely. Called. Absolutely. Yeah. I agree with that.
So
not that it would have been a good play, but I would love to know what he does if you shove the river.
I actually, when the river hit, I go, I could definitely represent this flush here, but I'm like, but does he have a flush? And I was trying to figure out if he'd call with a set. I didn't think he'd call with just a king, but I didn't know if I didn't know if I really wanted to turn top two into a bluff there on the river.
Right. I think you'd probably get a crying call with the set, because I think these guys get attached to the streets that they've already played, and they have a hard time folding rivers like
and
that.
And you also got, I mean, I don't know how worth it is on the river to turn my hand into a bluff there when I still have, you know, and a satellite anyways.
Yeah. Yep.
Right.
Agreed.
So when you say they were giving away seats in the cash games, does that mean that some of these people were essentially free, like they were free rolled into these things? I mean, they obviously had to play, but
like they do.
Some of them might even be like, I don't even like tournaments, but I'm just going to go play. And
they do.
So basically, like,
try to get all my chips.
Like
in.
A few times a day, they just go to the cash game tables and high card and give away a seat. Is that?
Yeah, something like that. They have a system where it picks out a random seat, and that person would win a ticket to this.
Yeah,
and they've been doing it for like 2 months up to now.
Yeah, there's a few tournament series that do that, and like the one in Chicago, and those are amazing because you just have all kinds of people that would never be playing a tournament playing like tournaments and the main events, even not just the satellites. Chicago, they give away I think like a couple dozen main event seats doing that.
Oh, I mean it's fantastic. Wow. It's a great idea. It just makes for different dynamics when you got to figure out what these people are thinking, because you know they more than likely didn't buy in.
Well, that's why you need to be very sociable at the beginning of the tournament, talk to everyone, and figure out if they're a free roll person or not.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, did you win?
So,
and then tell them that you won your seat and that you hate tournaments.
As I'm the only one in the entire room with a patch on. Oh yeah, I won my seat too. You don't see me here all the time.
Too funny.
All right, so second hands from a $200 re-entry tournament. We're past the re-entry period. Effective stacks were 12K. Blinds are 200, 400 with a 50. The table is playing kind of loose, not super aggressive. There were a few young kids at the table that obviously knew what they were doing, but then you also had your mixture of older guys that had no clue what they were doing. So effective stacks were 30 big blinds deep. I made it 900 from middle position with two jacks. The button flat and the big blind flat. And the big blind seemed like an incompetent young kid. Mm-hmm. Like he kind of was just clueless. They both had me covered. The flop was queen of spades, four of spades, queen of whatever. It doesn't really matter. There's 3450 in the flop, or 3450 in the pot. So the big blind checks. I just bet 1,050. Figured I'd find out my information pretty quickly. The guy on the button plays really straightforward. And then the young kid just really was kind of clueless. They both called. Should I be betting more? Do you think my bet size is fine? I figure the one thing that I realize is nobody has any clue there how much is in the pot.
Right.
So you can bet whatever you want to get whatever information you want. Nobody has any idea how to deduce anything.
They just see a bet. And there's no further variation on what that bet means. It's just a bet.
Yeah.
Right.
So, I'm always trying to figure out hand ranges. So when they both call, it's very, very unlikely that someone's just calling you with, with ace high or king jack or something like that. So
flush draw.
There's a decent chance someone has a pair under the queen. There's a decent chance someone has a flush draw, and there's a pretty decent chance that one of them has a queen. So
those are basically
your three options.
What was the third card? Queen.
Queen of spades, four of spades.
Oh, okay.
Queen of whatever. I don't remember the suit.
Yeah. Queen, four, two spades.
I'm trying to think of any fours that are in their ranges.
Ace four suited.
Ace four. Yeah. Maybe
four, three, five, four.
Right. So there are possibly some fours.
Yeah.
And then obvious some queen. Weak queens, right? I mean.
Yeah. No. Absolutely.
Right. Right. Yeah. And you said there was a flush draw on the board too?
Yeah, there's a flush draw on the flop. Okay.
All right. Yeah. So, because of that, I probably would have bet a little bigger.
Flush draw.
Yeah.
Planning on getting it in.
Yeah.
I disagree with that. I want to control the size of the pot in case I'm beat. I'm not worried about a flush, and then I definitely don't want to get it in on a queen four flop with jacks when there's a chance someone could have a queen. So I'm going to try and get as much information as I can and make the best decision I can and give myself a chance to get value from pocket sevens. If you bet too much, you're liable to get sevens to fold. You don't want sevens to fold.
I like
a small bet because you can allow yourself to get more information on multiple streets. Plus, you're not going to price out the hands that you want to keep in. and you can control the size of the pot if you're beat, or, you know, if a flush, like, no one's going to fold a flush draw anyway.
Good
so
point. Good
you
point.
Don't need to, you know, to try and bet it out, because they're never going to fold a flush draw.
That's true.
Solid, so, you know, keep
sense.
Them in, get value, and reevaluate on each street.
I mean, that was kind of my reasoning for betting small. I figure if you bet bigger, you're planning on getting and hoping they have a flush draw. I mean, you know, I only had 30 big blinds to start the hand. I'm trying to control the pot here. I didn't expect both of them to call. That kind of caught me by surprise.
Right. So then, you know, before the turn comes, I'm kind of figuring out what I'm going to do based on what card comes. And my general strategy is probably going to be to pot control. And if one of them has a queen, I'm going to hope it's the big blind, because he's probably going to check the turn as well.
Yeah.
And maybe you can induce a bluff out of the guy in the button if you check to him, and kind
and
of
I'll find out,
you know,
where I am
and sort of, you know, play it that way would probably be my thinking, depending on what
no,
comes.
No, I completely agree. So 6,600 in the pot, and the turn's the eight of spades.
Okay.
So the flush draw gets there.
And you do or don't have a jack of spades?
I don't have the jack of spades.
Okay.
So the big blind checks. I just checked. I don't really think there's much value in me betting here.
Right. Now, are you checking fairly quickly, or are you taking your time?
I take my time. I almost always take my time once I get in the pot and think about it. Unless it's, you know, a really, really, really small pot, and we're just trying to get through the, you know, I'm usually, once the pot gets built a little bit, I'm taking my time and thinking about it.
Okay.
So I check after Hemming and Hawn for, you know, I mean, taking my time for me is probably 10 seconds. It's not, you know, I don't ever take.
It's just giving them a chance not to really know what you have. Like, you know, basically putting doubt in their mind on what you might be doing or thinking.
Exactly.
What you could have. Yeah.
So then the button checks. So the river's another queen. So the board's queen, four, queen, eight, queen.
Okay. That's a pretty good river.
6,600 in the pot. And the big blind throws out six yellows. 6,000.
Wow.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I'm going, really?
Dirty.
I tanked for a while.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's my thoughts exactly. Like, okay.
That's
I couldn't see him turning a flush into a bluff here.
No.
Yeah.
I think he might going to be with nines or tens.
I don't think he's ever going to bet pot with nines or tens. He should either have a queen or he's bluffing, right? Like, it's,
yeah,
you know. It's kind of hard to be bluffing because he overcalled.
Yeah.
Again, not usually is he going to turn a flush draw into a bluff. So is he going to overcall with a four and then try to represent quads? It's pretty interesting.
Yeah. I really didn't know. I mean, I wanted to fold.
Right. It's tough to get complete information because there's still a live player behind, so you don't want to really talk too much or give away much about your hand because there's still that guy behind.
Oh, I didn't. I mean, I didn't say anything at all. I just sat there thinking.
Like, if I was going to call, I'd try to look as weak as possible, so maybe I get a weak overcall as well.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you're going to fold, then it really doesn't matter.
Yeah. And I still would have. With calling, I had 4,000 behind, so, I mean, I'm not dead. I'm down to 10 bigs.
Yeah.
I ended up calling after probably a good minute and a half.
Right.
And then the button folded his four face up, and he goes, if you hadn't called, I was calling.
I love when they say that.
He had queen jack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I just don't think I'm good enough to fold here. I mean, I should be. And then after the fact, I thought about it more and more, and I'm like, maybe I should just be folding that river. I mean, he's betting pot. I mean,
how is he betting pot without a queen?
Yeah, it's just, you know, figuring out his complete hand range and figuring out what he would do with all those hands. And basically, there's not very many hands he's making that bet with. But you did say he's incompetent, so that kind of, you know, makes it easier to talk yourself into.
Yeah, that was part of my reasoning. I'm going, this guy really doesn't know what he's doing.
And
right.
Your hands also.
Check the turn. I should bet and try and win this.
Yeah, your hands also way under repped, which always kind of makes it a little bit difficult because you're not.
Yeah, I
really
felt this way.
You don't think that they don't think that they think you have a real hand. So.
Yeah.
Right. So, and we've all seen plenty of people make calls on like a double paired board or something and can't fathom why their flush is not good. Stuff like that. I mean, you know, bad players do weird things.
He was disappointed that no one bet the turn and he had a flush, so he was just planning on bombing the river and then didn't really notice.
Didn't realize that there's trips on the board.
But if you stare at him long enough, you may be able to realize that he looked down and now saw that he's in trouble. But
right. But you know, the thing about this hand, which I know the other hand was a satellite, is I just hate being in the position where I'm the guy making all these calls without, you know, really having the having much information or being the aggressor in the hands. I try to conserve my chips for the situations where I can, you know, put more control in. Now I know, you know, we have to think about his range and if we're ahead of it, but I hate just finding myself in these spots. I don't know is there a way to avoid being in Sean's spot where he's just making calls? Could he have done something on the turn and then gotten away from it, or is this just, you know, all he could do in this spot?
No, I think his best line is the one that he took.
Right.
You know, sometimes I'm going to even check the flop, but I don't mind the small bet to try and give yourself a better chance to get more information or complete information.
Right.
I think a bet on the turn would just be wasting chips because it's
a
really, really good chance that someone has a flush or a queen.
Right.
So there's not much point putting any more money into the pot. You know, my approach for, you know, the last long while has been, you know, small ball and you know, trust yourselves to make the right decisions and the right reads post flop because that's where the edge is.
Right.
So, you know, the more pots you play and the more streets you play, you should be able to get more and more information and just trust yourself to make the right decision.
So one of the things that we probably should take from this hand is that, you know, his small bet on the turn, I'm sorry, his small bet on the flop and checking behind on the turn allowed Sean to actually have the ability to make a decision on the river without being committed for his entire stack.
Right.
Yeah.
And it also, you know, it gave somebody, you know, it's inducing bluffs, it's pot controlling.
Right. Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Controlling the size of the pot when you're beat and then, you know.
Maximizing your value when you're ahead.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And that's the spot he put himself in. It's just unfortunate.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I definitely like being the aggressor, but I mean, there's certain situations like this where I just don't know at what point I could have tried to take over the hand with the stacks the way they were.
Right. Agreed. Yeah, 30 bigs is not so.
Yeah.
Bad, right. Yep.
So, all right. Now a couple fun hands from the main. Well, at least one's fun, and hopefully I don't look like an idiot in both of them. effective stacks are 24K. I had, I want to say like 40,000, but the effective stacks for the hand are 24,000. The blinds are 153 with a quarter. It folds to me on the button. I made it 700 with 10-7 offsuit. The small blind and the big blind both flat. Small blind seemed rather competent. A slightly older gentleman, probably early 40s. Big blind was a guy, we were back where the high-stakes cash game tables were. There was 10-20 games going on, and he kept making sure his name was on the list. So he kind of wanted out of there. I don't really,
right.
You know, he just – He saw how juicy the game was, and it didn't really seem like he cared about the tournament that much.
All right.
So he flats, and he literally just asked the brush to make sure his name was on the list a few, like, two hands before this. So 23.50 in the pot. The flops, jack of diamonds, ten of diamonds, random three. I don't have any diamonds in my hand. They both checked to me. There's 23.50 in there, so I went ahead and bet 9.25.
Okay.
I think I have the best hand at this point, and I want to charge flush draws.
Wait, what was the flop again?
Jack of diamonds, ten of diamonds, three.
Oh, ten of diamonds. Okay, all right. So you have a pair of tens. Yep.
So I have second pair with a seven.
Got it.
So I bet 9.25 on the flop. What do you think?
First off, before the flop comes, I'm always trying to, and what I'm always trying to coach and teach is for people to always be thinking about hand ranges, at all times of every hand.
Yeah.
So pre-flop, I'm always trying to assign ranges as well, just so you get a better idea when the flop comes and, you know, flop texture and stuff. You know, the small blind, who you think is someone competent, he's calling a button raise, you figure he has a pretty decent, like a decent hand, not a really strong hand that he's going to re-raise with, but a decent hand. So he could have a small medium pair. He could have ace X or like kind of two paint hands, like, you know, Jack 10, King Queen, Queen Jack,
or even like a suited connector hands.
Yeah. So I'm not a big fan of the flop for his hand range.
Yeah.
The big blind, from everything you said, I'd assign his hand range on any two cards, right? Yeah. So basically I'm playing, you know, heads up against the small blind and just, you know, aware that the big blind could have just about anything.
Okay.
So I don't really like that flop for what I'm giving the small blind.
But when they both check, I think I need to bet for information.
Yeah, like there's basically your heads up. So you could either bet, and if you get called, you could then check behind the turn for pot control.
That was
or
my plan.
Or you could check behind the flop for pot control and maybe induce a bluff, but then you are giving two of them three cards.
Exactly.
And
that's part of my reasoning, is I wanted to ideally get heads up.
Right. I think in this spot I like the bet, and I like, you know, you kept it small to still control the pot. You know, of course you're giving yourself a, you know, chance to maybe get bluffed or semi-bluffed off the hand by allowing one of them to check raise you, but they're not, you know, there's not many people that are going to do that in the flop. Even if he has Jack 10, a lot of times they're just going to, you know, slow play and just call and allow you to check behind the turn. So
small blind folds, big blind calls.
Okay.
Three scenario. So there's 4,200 in the pot. The turn is a Jack. So the board's Jack 10, 3, Jack. And 4,200, and the big blind leads for 2,000.
It's interesting.
Yeah.
So, you know, my starting plan when the Jack comes is, you know, you have two decisions. You bet for value to try and get value out of, you know, tens or draws or whatever. Yeah.
You know,
because you can't have the best 10, or because he could easily have a better 10, I'm probably going to check behind if he checks there most of the time.
Yeah.
But when he leads half pot, then you're, okay, is he ever going to do that with a 10? Not likely, so he should have 8-9, king, queen, the flush draw, or a 10, or just some random.
I don't think he's ever leading with a jack either.
Right, that's what I was going to interject.
He could, but I don't know if I give him enough credit for doing that.
Right.
Maybe.
I don't think it's that random for someone to be leading with a jack there. You call the top pair and you turn trips, you know, most, like, I don't think it's that rare that people are going to come out betting. You know, I'm often going to, and cash game players are often going to, because they're just, you know, trying to get value. You don't expect someone with aces to bet on the turn, even when the second jack comes. So, like, I don't think slow playing trip jacks there is really going to be that common, because you don't expect the other person to ever bet. So I think if he has a jack, he's definitely going to, not definitely, but I think a large percentage of the time he's going to lead. So you should have, like, I don't think you have to then worry about your 10 being good, because he either has a jack or a draw. So,
yeah.
Right.
So I decided to just go ahead and call the turn. I don't really see any value in raising the turn for sure. And I honestly didn't give him a whole lot of credit for having a jack here.
Right.
I figured he'd probably try and put in a check raise, and figuring I'm going to two barrel because I'm the young kid wearing a patch.
Yeah. Thank you for expressing. That's kind of why I
felt
that way.
That's another dynamic, is I'd been rather aggressive at the table. So that's one of the reasons I don't think he's leading a jack there. So I put him on a draw, possibly a 10, or honestly just a bluff.
Okay.
So I call, so there's 8,200 in the pot, and then the river's a queen. So the board's Jack 10, 3, Jack, queen. And he leads 5,000.
Hmm.
Okay. And now, don't expect him to be betting like king queen for value on the river. Like, you know, so
he's probably gonna check call king queen for value, I'm guessing.
Yeah, most likely.
He could have 8-9.
Yeah, so 8-9 got there.
Flush draw.
Flush draws missed.
I was worried that he's bluffing with a better 10.
Right. I don't think that is going, again, like, we don't know that much about the opponent.
Yeah, it's hard, but
if he's thinking at all, he's probably not playing a 10 this way, unless he just hated his kicker and then decided to maybe try and get you to fold. Like, just, it's not like all of a sudden it's like, oh, okay, in case my 10's not good, let me see if I can try and get him to fold aces on the turn in the river. Most people aren't able to just change their thinking like that from the flop to the turn.
What was in the pot when he bet 5K?
8,200.
Okay. Seems like a value bet.
But like I said, I don't think he had any idea how much was in the pot.
Okay. All right.
He bet 2,000 on the turn, 5,000 on the river. It's pretty standard bet sizing, I guess. Yeah. It's just, you know, figuring out all possible hands and I guess whether or not
I just
think you're good enough to make the call.
Yeah, I mean, I just really thought he could definitely lead with a flush draw on the turn, and he could definitely bluff his flush draws on the river. I was kind of afraid of 8-9. Like you said, I don't know if he's valuing king-queen there, which is definitely in his range. I think he's just going to check call king-queen.
Yeah.
He's definitely going to lead a jack, but I really honestly didn't give him credit for leading a jack on the turn. So, turn. So, I took a while.
8-9 or just...
Yeah. 8-9, I was possibly worried that, you know, he had turned a 10 into a bluff, but, I mean, most of his 10s with bad kickers I'm chopping against anyways.
Right.
Or just a complete bluff. So I ended up calling, which could be bad. I'm really still not sold 100% either way. And he had deuce three off, so he had bottom pair.
Okay.
Okay.
Wow.
Ranted and raved about how bad it was.
So that's, you know, obviously being in position helps you a ton in that hand. It makes it much easier to, you know, to call down in those spots. You know, I definitely like the call on the turn. Because I think there's, you know, such a huge range of hands that he has that you're still beating. And then the river really doesn't change that much because, as we said, we don't expect him to be betting a queen anyway. All it changes is that the straight draw got there. So it still leads all the, you know, semi-bluffs and missed draws and
right.
stuff.
Right, and it's only one side of the straight draw because he'd have to have ace-king to have the other side, which he clearly, you know, he's not going to have.
Yeah, I can't expect him
pre-flop.
Not
right,
to put that in pre-flop with ace-king.
Right.
Well, there's also king-nine, but again, that's...
Oh, right.
That's
yeah.
Role, but the bet on the flop was small, so you don't want to discount gutter balls from
that's true.
In the big that one definitely didn't cross my mind, the king-nine. I was going through all his hands, and I just kind of have a feeling when somebody just doesn't care anymore, and that was kind of the impression I got.
Yeah.
And probably wanted to show the young kid a lesson.
Yeah.
Yeah. He showed you.
Yeah, and then he got seated at 10:20 a few minutes later, and I could hear him ranting and raving and pointing to me about how bad I was.
Awesome.
I didn't know. Right. I never say anything. I'm just like, yep. And then, of course, for the next hour, I got, every time I open, I got that 10-7 again, don't you? So
that's good.
So what I thought it was an interesting hand.
Definitely.
So this is late in day one. Effective stacks are about 90,000. The blinds are 1,200, 2,400. I had 3-bet folded within the last orbit. There was a kid too on my right that was really good. The guy on my left was a high stakes cash game player, a younger guy that he was really good as well. I've been playing pretty aggressive, so I definitely I'm living up to the reputation of the young internet kid. I opened 10-9 offsuit under the gun to 5,100 at 1,200, 2,400.
Why?
Yeah, we can talk about that. It might be bad. Whatever. I mean, the way the table was, I thought it was fine. I mean, I'm trying to mix in some, you know, garbagey hands under the gun based on the way the table is playing. So... I guess we can discuss that, even though, whatever.
Well, just the way you say it, it sounds like you kind of know that it's not great.
Well, I know it's not great, but it's one of those things you kind of had to be there with the table dynamics and everything. I would get more respect for my under-the-gun raises than I definitely would for my middle position, late position raises.
Right.
So basically it could have been any two cards. It didn't really matter.
Well, you said, like, you know, one of the toughest players is directly on your left, so he's not liable to mess with you when you raise under the gun. And then you said another competent player would have been in the big blind this hand?
What was he in the big blind? Yeah.
He would have been small blind?
Small blind.
Okay. Well, that's, you know, honestly, if you're going to pick your raise spots on the table, this may be your, you know, one of your best opening spots every orbit because you have one good player in the small blind and the other one under the gun plus one, and neither one of them are probably going to give you much resistance, you know, in those positions.
Yeah.
I guess the other one would be when you're on the button and that guy's in the small blind. Those would probably be your, you know, your best two opening spots. The only time that guy isn't able to flat you in position and, and the other guy's not involved in the hand either. So.
Well, yeah, I mean, the hand that went down a few hands before was the kid two to my right had opened. I three bet him, I forget with what, like 8-9 of hearts or something random. And then the guy on my left cold four bet, and so we both folded. And right. The kid's like, I'm pretty sure I folded the best hand. So, I mean, there were dynamics between the two of us, but really the table had gotten really soft other than that.
Okay, now is this near the end of day one? Are you guys close to the money or not yet?
No,
or?
It was a day 1A and day 1B tournament. So.
Oh, okay. So just getting towards the end of the day.
Yeah, we're still going to have a decent bubble on day two.
Okay.
So I make it 5,100. I get flatted by the guy on my left, the aggressive guy that was pretty laggy. And then I got flatted by a girl on the button.
Okay.
So there's 19,200 in the pot. The flop is
okay, before you say the flop. No, just okay. You know, my standard thing here is just to again kind of figure out hand ranges right before the flop comes. So you know the guy on my left here, he cold four bet. He's young. He's a high stakes cash guy or whatever you say. He's pretty competent, pretty tough. When he's flatting, you're under the gun range. I don't expect him to really be doing it that light unless you've seen it before. So I expect him to have actually kind of a real hand here because he's not three betting it. Like he's not, semi-bluffing. He actually probably has a hand that he's playing for value, like ace queen, ace jack suited, maybe, king queen or, a kind of mid-low pocket pair.
How deep are you guys again?
Like 40, just under 40 bits? 35. Yeah.
35,
40 bits. Okay. All right.
And so, then the woman, I guess it's all based on information. If you think she's tight or if she's going to be calling.
She got to the table within 15 hands, so I didn't really have a whole lot of information on her.
Okay.
So, she had played a couple of them, and then and she put in she put in two raises on the flop, and both times people folded. So to that point, she was a young girl. She seemed, rather competent. So, but I also gave her credit for being, a decently aggressive player from what I had seen.
Okay.
So, the flop's king of hearts, ten of hearts, nine.
Okay.
I go ahead and I lead for 14,300. So I flop bottom two.
Yeah.
So I bet three quarter pot. The guy folds. And she check raises to 33,000. Or she didn't check raise. She just raised to 33,000 on the button.
Okay, can I just ask you one quick question? Why you bet three quarters of the pot this time when other hands that you've played, you've bet like, 30 or 40% of the pot?
Because I was out of position. Well, I'm out of position here too. At the other tables, I didn't have nearly as strong of a hand. I wanted to get value for my hands. I mean, I was willing to play for stacks, obviously, on the flop here.
Right. I don't know if this is standard, but like if I'm playing against you for a while, I'm quite likely to pick up your bet sizing tells in terms of you're betting low with kind of weak hands and bombing it when you have it, right?
I completely agree. But you have to come to Florida and see that nobody here really has it. Most of these people have no idea.
Right. Well, but you said the one guy in this hand is confident.
Yeah.
The only problem I have with the bet is that you're gonna push him out with all of his he's less likely to float you. He's less likely to call you with middle pair or some sort of draw because you're just pricing him out and he might just decide it's not the best time to try and get tricky with you. So that I just don't like
So betting like 8,000 to 9,000 would probably be more.
You guys really aren't that deep. The pot's already pretty big. Like I like to stay consistent. I'm going to bet probably like 40 to 50% of the pot, and give him a chance to float, give him a chance to make a move, give him a chance to call me down with middle pair or some sort of gutter ball. If he has ace jack, ace queen, he's definitely going to semi float your C bet, but if you bomb three quarters pot, he might just decide, this guy's really serious about this hand. I'll just get out of the way and give him this one.
Right. Yeah, you're right. I mean, also it had been a long day. I was tired and I just figured, well, I fought the big hand. Let's get some chips in the middle. And I really wasn't giving most of the people at the table credit for.
I'd rather check raise than I would. Just lead out bombing because at least by check raising, you're giving them a chance to put some chips in the middle. I just think way too often you're just going to force them out of the pot and just win the hand.
No, you're right.
when you flop huge. But, makes sense. So she raises.
She makes a 33,000. And I just stuck it all in. I figured there's so many hands in her range that, you know, ace, queen of hearts, king, jack. I mean, there's just so many hands that she's probably not folding. I figured my bottom two pair were more than likely good against her range there.
Right. Like, it's obviously harder for her to have a set of tens or set of nines. She's not going to have a set of kings.
And I still had fold equities, you know, to a certain extent. She had probably 160,000 to start the hand.
Right, but she's never going to fold better than you. So fold equity.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Doesn't really matter. You're trying to get her to call with worse.
Yeah.
You know, at that point you can't really just flat her there's already so much money in the middle. It's either, you know, obviously you're going with it. You know, like, she's never going to fold better, so fold equity doesn't I
that's
think,
true.
Is right, because you're not trying to get her fold, you're just trying to get it in, or, you know.
I used the wrong term there.
Well, I don't know. If she has some huge combo draw, she can't fold anyway. She's folding her bluffs, and she's calling with just about everything else, except maybe she hero folds, like, king-jack or king-queen, because she just thinks she's beaten, decides not to get it in with you. So in that regards, I get, like, you have fold equity over those hands that you're ahead of that, you know, could obviously draw out on you. But
yeah. And didn't you say she had raised two flops?
She had raised two flops and folded, so it was kind of, you know, I'm just like, well, it was... I'll be honest, it wasn't necessarily the best thinking on my part, but I'm just kind of like, if she has better, so be it. I'm just getting it in here. 35 big blinds, my hand, you know, it's not putting me on bottom two here, I can assure you of that.
Right.
Right.
It's hard for her to have, like, you know, there's King 10 is obviously the most logical hand that might have you beat, or, of course, Queen Jack if she just flopped the nuts.
Yeah.
You don't think it's possible she has the set? I mean,
it's just
possible, but...
It's less likely because, you know, Sean has a 10 and a 9 in his hand, so, you know...
Oh, right, right.
Then a 1-outer for her to bink a set of 9s or 10s. And
never mind. That's right.
I don't think she ever has kings. So basically, like, King 10 or Queen Jack are the hands, you know, I'm most worried about. And then obviously just trying to get it in against King Jack, King Queen, or, you know, combo flush draw or something like that.
Ace Jack of Hearts or Ace Queen of Hearts or whatever. Yeah. So I got it in, and she did have Queen Jack, but I hit a nice little 9 on the turn for a nice little
10.
I mean, I don't know.
That's so dirty.
I think check raising would have been better. Once I lead, I kind of think the hand plays itself. I'm never folding, you know, 35 big blinds deep.
Yeah. Like, you're never folding anyway. Like, you know, if you did decide to go for the check raise and she bets, then maybe you end up not even check raise. Like, if the guy didn't bet, like if I ended up saying, okay, maybe I'll try and play this a bit different and maybe go for a check raise, and I check and the guy checks and then she bets, I'm probably not even raised at that point because I want to try and maybe let that guy do something crazy, or, you know,
and
at least give him a chance, or give the, you know, lady a chance maybe to bluff again or get more value later. So I might even just call, and then obviously you would have voted on the turn, but you know, so then maybe you check raise or even lead or do different things once your head's up against her, because then it's just trying to get max value from her.
The only
thing I don't like is just the bomb on the flop, because you don't want to fold out the hand. Like, obviously she's not folding huge draws or the nuts. doesn't matter. But you don't want to push out the, you know, the floats or the light calls, or giving them a chance to maybe bluff, right? Like, if you were planning on bluffing a flop bet, you're probably not going to choose the time when the guy just bombs three quarters pot to...
Yeah, that's true. You're going to give him credit for having a hand there.
You're usually going to raise the ones where it makes it look like they're kind of maybe betting weak, or, you know, kind of trying to control the size of the pot or something like that.
Yeah, you're right. So definitely a mistake on my part.
Yeah. Did she berate you afterwards for raising with 9-10 off?
She even came
back when I made the final table, and she was like, I'm so proud to use my chips well.
Yeah. So what was the so tell us about the final table. Who was there? Was it a six-handed or an eight-handed or a nine-handed? How many?
No, it was ten-handed.
It was a ten-handed. Okay, ten-handed.
Yeah, it was ten-handed. And then basically when we were five and six before we went to the final table, it was me, Clemente, D-Fish, and Corey on our five-handed table. And when we got five-handed, it was the same four of us and one of the guys from the other table.
Well, explain who those guys are.
Oh, Daryl Fish is D-Fish online.
Yep, right.
Very good player. Commander Cool, Corey Burbick, he's really good. He was on my right. And then Dan Clemente, who I didn't know at the time, and he had a huge chip lead once we got to the final table. He plays well, but he also ran really well, too. Right. He has a bunch of live scores. I didn't realize it at the time.
Yeah. So the cream really rised to the top at that tournament, huh?
Yeah, it definitely did. So.
And what were your table? What were your positions again?
Clemente was on. Clemente had the huge chip lead, and he was on my left, so it kind of hindered.
Oh, that sucks. Yeah.
Yeah, and especially because with the blinds went up not super rapidly, but every 40 minutes, kind of quick for a WPT 2K final table.
Right.
Yeah.
And so the average stack definitely got shallower rather quickly. And we, when we were six-handed, there was four of us all within, like, 15 to 23 big blinds. And then Daryl Fish had probably 30 or 35 big blinds, and then Clemente had, like, half the chips in play.
Right.
So, and the pay jumps were kind of weird, so it's more or less making sure you didn't make any ICM fails. We were all just kind of waiting for one another to bust, you know?
Right. How'd you go out?
Five-handed. I raised ace-jack off. We were all min-raising at that point. Ace-jack off under – I mean, I'm basically min-raising the entire tournament, maybe, right. You know, 300, 150, 300 to make it 700. You know, that's basically what I do. But at this point, all five of us are min-raising. I made it two big blinds. Daryl shoved from the small blind. I had ace-jack off. I just think it's way too strong to be folding five-handed with 22 big blinds. I'm just asking to get fifth of them raised folding. 22 big blinds.
So how many blinds? Daryl, had you covered with 30? And
he had just knocked out the guy that got six, so at this point he was up to about 50. We played six-handed for a while.
Yeah, and the big blind was obviously shorter than you?
The big blind was Corey, and Corey only had 19 big blinds.
Okay, so you opened the button with 22.
I opened under the gun.
Oh, okay.
Five-handed.
And Fish shoved on you from the small blind.
From the small blind, yeah.
Having both of you covered with both of you having, like, you know, 20 to 18 bigs.
Yeah.
It's
I mean, it was close. I tanked. Because
you're raising into the chip leader this hand, too, right? You're opening a 22 big blind stack.
Yeah.
Under the gun, raising into the chip leader and all these shove stacks.
Yeah.
It's probably close to the bottom of your range, right? I guess, you know, five-hand, you're opening ace ten, maybe suited aces, king, queen, hands like that. But
and I mean, I think I could probably open just for a steal with some other hands as well and raise fold.
Right.
Probably not a lot, but I mean, I definitely could be.
Right. Like if I'm Fish there, you know, obviously because of the ICM dynamics and stuff, maybe he can get you to make a tight fold because of that. Like I don't think he's ever doing it with there.
Yeah.
But he probably has. Like, you know, he's definitely capable of maybe doing it with, like, 9-10 suited or something just because he thinks maybe he can get you to make a laydown because of the stack dynamics and stuff. But, I'm going to be definitely concerned that you probably have a hand that you're going with just because of your stack size and where you're opening from.
Yeah. I tanked for probably a minute, and I call, and he goes, oh, I think we have the same hand. And he flipped over King-Queen.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And
one other question I had, and I asked Casey about this too, and I'm anxious to see what Mike says. It folded to Corey in the small blind. He had, this is probably the orbit before that, he had 18 big blinds, and he shoved from the small blind. I had 25
Well, before you even tell me your hand, I'll just kind of...
Oh, no, I know. I wasn't going to tell you my hand.
All
right. What was your calling range of 18 big blind shove from Commander Cool from the small blind?
So this is five-handed?
Yes.
Five-handed.
Sure, yeah, we had been five-handed for one orbit.
Okay, so falls with him, and he just open shoves 18 bigs, and you have 22 bigs?
I had 25.
25. Yeah. calling with probably ace. Yeah, definitely ace 8 plus. Maybe talking myself into a call with ace 7. King queen for sure. And probably pocket 5s or better.
Okay.
Some in that range. Obviously, I don't know how many times he's done this before or if he's been
first time
shoving his entire – it's first time he's ever shoved.
Yeah.
So, well, like,
blind versus blind.
Right. So I definitely – like, I absolutely exclude, like, any monsters.
Yeah.
Like, if he has – you know, if he has ace – you know, ace 10 or maybe even like ace 8 or better, he's going to be raising to induce. Probably king queen, maybe even, you know, king jack. And then, you know, probably 7s plus. He might just jam 6s, 5s, 4s, all those hands. So, like, basically, my calling range is something that is going to have his shoving range dominated. Right.
I
don't want to just call off with ace deuce because, you know, who knows?
Probably
chopping or racing. Like, I'm calling with hands that I'm hopefully going to have them dominated with. So.
And there was another guy at the table with 16 big blinds at the time as well.
Right.
So, I mean, you know, I'm sure the pay jump doesn't make a big difference to him, but, you know,
it
does have an impact.
Corey's going to shove kind of, you know, he's going to shove a pretty wide range here, I think, just because he knows it's really tough for you to call and it's blind on blind. You know, he's probably shoving all of his jack 10s, 10-9 suited, and you know, I think he's shoving a decent range here, but never a monster. And I don't think he's just gonna jam junk here in this spot. But
yeah, I folded ace 5.
Yeah,
that's.
I knew it was real close.
Yeah, and I think, given the stacks and everything, I think that's probably I would do the same. As I said, like I ace 8 I. snap comfortably.
Yeah.
A7, I might find a call, and A6, I might find a fold, and A5, I probably fold.
He told me later he had twos.
Yeah. Yep. And that's kind of
which makes
know,
sense.
What I expect him to
shove
with is, you know, smallish pairs, and then kind of just a sort of a half decent kind of hand like ace rag or jack 10 or queen jack kind of thing.
Yeah.
Right. What was Casey's take on that hand?
He said A7 plus, I think 4s plus, but it might have been 5s, and king queen.
So pretty much spot
exactly
on.
Exactly the same, yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
That's scary.
And I mean, I knew A5 was real close. I just was making sure.
Yeah.
It's funny that you and Casey arrived at the same thing because you guys play so differently.
Yeah, that's what I'm kind of, like, all right.
Yeah, but you know what? I mean, calling is different
calling
than...
Calling range is different than...
Exactly. Yeah, calling range, I think you could become a little... You could be a little closer. Good players have closer calling ranges as opposed to what they're doing.
I play a lot of aspects of my game. Maybe, obviously, probably a lot different and nittier than Casey, but... Calling all ends is pretty.
Because there's just one step: figure out what they have, right?
Yep.
So you, the good players will probably converge on theories there. So,
cool,
right?
Good stuff.
Right. Well, cool. I guess we should probably wrap it up here. Want to thank you guys both for joining us, of course. As a reminder, make sure and check out Mike's new website, mikeleah.com, L-E-A-H, for those of you who don't know how to spell the last name. So go over there and check out his website. And congrats again, Sean. Yes. Really nice run.
Nice run.
Very good. All right, good luck in the Turbo Live. Coupe, Mike.
Thank you. Happy holidays, everyone.
Happy holidays to you guys, too.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right. You, too.
Take care.
Cool. All right, we'll take a break, and then we'll come back here and wrap it up on the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. Welcome back, everybody, to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. I want to say thank you to Sean and Mike for joining us today. Great conversation.
Yeah, man, Mike is such a hand reader. That's just amazing.
Yeah, it really influences me to try to do a better job of reconstructing hands when I think about him, because he's very methodical in the way that he wants to talk about and think about hands.
Did you notice how many times he stopped us from moving to the flop before we gave a range?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, like, well, before we do that, let's stop and think about what all these guys could have. And I don't spend as much time doing that as I should.
I
spend a lot of time going, okay, you know, it was four-handed, and I see bet, and then three guys folded. And you never stop to think about what anybody could have had, and should you be c-betting, and how much.
And it's funny that the comparison to Big Bill came up at the end, because they do play so differently, and they obviously both have such great success. And you know, you try to think about, you know, you there's so many different ways to be successful in poker, you know, and Mike's way, I think Mike is appropriately aggressive when he, you know, I mean, I think he can run bluffs and he can, you know, build big pots, but I think his biggest strength is he knows he can read hands so well, and he just knows where he is so often and knows how to range people as well as anyone. I mean, of course, Big Dog is very good at that as well. But they take that information and they do different things with them. And Mike just is, you know, all about understanding ranges and what people do. So it's really fun to do it. And that's what he does in his videos too, which is why his videos are so popular. Because he's just
right.
I mean, what we just did here with him on this podcast and those conversations about those hands, he does that talking to himself in the videos.
Right.
But it's good because it stops and forces you to do it. So I've now what I do when I watch his videos is I stop the video before he says anything. You know, like when someone, you know, calls him, or, you know, if there's a flop, and I try to like do what he does and try to, you know, try to get it right. You know, and you get better and better at it as you do it. So it's been fun to watch, fun to do that. You know, getting better.
Yeah.
Watching his videos.
Yep. Yeah. I thought it was really interesting. And obviously congrats to Sean for making such a good run. I mean, obviously I know he'd like to have won or finished higher, but, you know, winning a big live tournament or you know, making that much money in a big live tournament is a huge accomplishment.
Absolutely.
Especially with that field. I mean, talking about the guys at the final
table. Yeah, his final table was pretty tough, man. Those guys are good. Like, we didn't give him – I don't think we even really – I mean, I know we gave him props on the strategy section, but the guys that – Fish and Commander Cool and Clemente, those guys are good. They're really good players. So, you know, congrats to him on that. Absolutely.
So, once again, thanks to those guys for stopping in. We'll make sure and try to get Mike on again sometime in the relatively near future, because he's so good.
Yeah, and definitely check out his website. Definitely go there.
Yeah. As a reminder, MikeLeah.com. Go over there and check that out. And let's talk about what we got. Speaking of websites, what we got going on at Tournament Poker Edge.
Right. So we got Mike's current series is actually running right now. It's at the W Coupe before he, you know, before he ran up to the player, you know, eighth place in the player of the year and chopped the main event. He recorded a live sweat for us early in the W Coupe, which we put up his main event first because, you know, there was so much interest in it. But this is a really great video, too, from the perspective of learning and, you know, all the things we just talked about, what he does. So we got Mike's video running right now. We have a really neat series. I think I mentioned this last week from T-Twist, Sticking It to Himself, Before and After with T-Twist, the Sunday Million. He talks about, you know, he reviews an old Sunday Million of his when he made a deep run, and it's really funny.
It's been fun to listen to.
It's a really funny video because he just can't believe some of the things he does and how much he's improved and learned since then. So that's running. Yeah. There are really cool theory videos running right now. So Daryl Jace, A-A-A-A-A-A-A. I don't know if that was 9 A's or not, but
Close enough.
He's been doing theory. He came in and did a hand history review for us. And he's a very – I think we also mentioned this last week, but he's a very methodical thinking player, also amazing at hand reading. And he's doing a couple of theory videos for us. First video was how to become a better poker player, which was cool because he – kind of walk you through how he studied. But now he has a three-part series on exploiting tendencies. So what to do if someone bets three bets too much, what to do if someone c-bets too much, what to do if someone calls too much, and with hand examples. Good reaction to that so far. So that's been a lot of fun to watch. And it's a three-parter, so it'll be continuing. We don't put theory videos up 1, 2, 3. We give you some time in between them because they're so intensive and so you know, thought-provoking. We want to give you time to work on and watch him a couple times. And then he has another theory video that's, you know, up for release eventually, relatively soon, on hand range, on ranging people. So that's right. that's exciting. And then he won the Merge 100K this Sunday, the, you know, the $100 Merge Major. He won it outright, and he's doing a hand history review on that for us. So so that'll be up relatively soon as well. So, you know, it's a lot of good videos going up. Oh, and more to mention, Brendor, you know, who just finished his first series with us, won the on game 1K on Monday night, and he actually turned the recorder on for the final table. So nice. That's coming out, and we have a new pro. We're gonna drop a TPE strategy podcast exclusive here. Ready to announce a new pro. Just been editing his videos, and his videos are going to be up next week. Derek, would you like to do the honors?
Yeah, sounds good. We're really excited to be adding our first UK pro, actually. Ben Kid Cardiff 6 Warrington. Many of you will probably recognize the name. He's had a ton of online success. He's been ranked as high as number one in the UK. And like I said, he's just won a boatload of online, huge online tournaments, yeah. FTOPs and things like that. So we're really excited about having him on board.
He, I'm the guy who edits the videos, right? His videos are awesome. His thought process is fantastic. Reminds me a lot of Brendor, and just the way he thinks through hands and walks you through it. Obviously, but with his own flair and his own style. I'm really excited to have him on. He's a great player. So there you go. We've got another pro rolling out.
Yep.
Pro after pro.
Yeah, it's a great time to be a member of TPE. Yeah. Not to toot our own horn, but I mean, we're just rolling out so many great videos and adding so many new pros that yeah. I mean, we used to talk about this all the time about how we started this site. It's a great time to be able to watch all these videos.
Yep.
Like I'm enjoying it as much as a member as I am as, you know, yeah. part of the team. So
well, I'm lucky. I get to chat like technical details with with Daryl and Brendor and now Ben and Mike. So I got these guys on my instant message. So
that's right.
I get to drop them hands that I have. So I'm like, cool. So yeah, welcome Ben. Like I said, video will premiere next week. So by the time many of you listen to this, it'll be live or be going live soon. So look out for that.
Yep. Looking forward
and
to
we'll,
it.
We'll announce when his video is up on Twitter. It should be, I'm not sure if we're going to do it Monday or Thursday. I have to look at the schedule to see what's slotted and what's still running. But
yeah,
get it out next week.
Soon enough. Cool. Anything else we need to cover?
No, don't forget to follow us on Twitter at TurnPokerEdge. So TOURN PokerEdge.
Yep.
And I'm at RonFezBuddy on Twitter. I'd love to connect anyone who listens to the podcast. Love to hear from you. If you have any questions about, you know, things that happen on the podcast or any of the hands or things that you want us to talk about on the podcast, just shoot us find us. Like I said, I'm at Ron Fezbuddy on Twitter, and I love talking about the podcast. Last year at the World Series, I got stopped by a couple people who were like, hey, you host the podcast, and because I was wearing a TPE shirt. Mm-hmm. And just some awesome, like, questions about some of the hands that came up and people wanted to talk about it. So we love talking about the podcast to anyone who's interested. As you could tell, we love talking about poker. So just hit us up on Twitter. We're there.
Yep, hit us up anytime. We're online a lot, especially at night yep. when we're grinding.
Yep.
So
yep. And we keep it updated on what's going on with the podcast and whatnot. So
yeah, love to hear from you guys. Cool. All right, well, let's wrap this one up. I guess this will be the last TPE podcast of 2011. So.
Absolutely. Happy holidays,
everybody.
Buddy.
Yep, you as well. Everybody out there, enjoy your holiday season, and Happy New Year to you all. And hopefully we'll all have a hugely successful poker 2012.
Poker
so.
In the USA. All I want for Christmas is poker.
That's right. One time, please.
It's funny, talking about Twitter, I tweeted that last night. I was just sitting around, and I tweeted that, and it got retweeted like 40 times.
That's great.
Everyone's saying all I want for Christmas is poker in the U.S. Bring it back, please.
Yeah. Santa, if you're listening.
Santa is a nit. He's a donk.
That's right. All right. Cool. All right. Well, we'll wrap it up here. But again, happy holidays and happy New Year to everybody out there. And we'll see you guys all in 2012 on the Tournament Poker Edge podcast.
See ya.
Hit me, raise it, baby, stay with me. Lock in intuition, play the cards with babes to start. And after she's been hooked, I'll play the one that's on her heart. Without a gun, and baby, when it's love, it's not rough, it is.